And now the purple dusk of twilight time steals across the meadows of my heart. High up in the sky, the little stars climb, always reminding me that we're apart. You wander down the lane and far away, leaving me a song that will not...
Hi, I'm John Solari, your host of The Method Actor Speaks, and today we have a very special guest coming back, the lovely, incredibly talented, the beautiful Lillian Miller. Thank you. This is the third time. I'm blessed to have you
on
the show.
Nice to see you again, John.
Let me shake my hand.
He's commenting on how gorgeous you look today. So thin.
Oh, so thin. Thanks to you.
Yeah, it's all that health advice I gave you.
It's true.
Yeah, it's rubbing off just being around me, you see. 30 pounds or what?
30 pounds.
Yeah. Don't you feel better?
Oh, 100% better.
Yeah, I mean, in every way, it just affects every part of your life when you lose all that weight.
It's true.
And also, you know, you're not going to die from a heart attack, stroke.
You know, I was telling the crew before that you came on that outside of Marilyn Monroe, you are the only one, you and her are the only ones that ever get into Actors Studio.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, God. I'm just thinking of that picture of Marilyn Monroe with the dress blowing up.
7 year itch, yeah.
Yeah, you know, it's funny because that guy who discovered Marilyn Monroe and shot that photograph, his name was Bruno Bernard, it was called Bernard of Hollywood. Yeah. He actually so-called discovered me in Europe.
Really?
Yes, he was the guy that got me into movies in the first place. He was a big-time photographer.
He discovered you?
Uh-huh. Wow. He discovered me. I was working in London. I was 23 years old, and I was working for the London Sun newspaper. Right. I was the page three girl, like every week or two over there. And one day I got this photographer to shoot me called Bruno Bernard, and they call him Bernardo Hollywood. And he shot my picture, and he said, you know, I discovered Marilyn Monroe. I'm going, yeah, right, you know what I mean. And he showed me that picture with the skirt blowing up, you know, over that, I don't know, with some kind of...
The grating,
air. And he says, yeah, that's my picture. Yeah. So it's very interesting how that, you know, happens.
Isn't that, and then here years later, you wind up at Actors Studio, and she's the only other one.
Yeah, well, it's a small world, and I guess from the world of Playboy, you know, I come, you know, to America as a Playmate of the Year. I think, besides myself, there's not been too many women from Playboy in the Actors Studio.
That's what I said, it's only you and Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah, oh, wow. I wonder where God is taking this. But they say there's no end to, you know, what you can achieve or where you can end up as long as you have an open mind and be very positive, you know.
And you do have an open mind, and you do a lot of things.
Yes, I believe in getting better with age. One of the few in Hollywood, I think.
Before we talk about your, you know, your reality show, I'll show this. I don't know if I can.
God, I forgot all my pictures.
If we could see this.
Nobody's going to see it. It's so small.
It's small, but it says that, well, the name of the magazine is called Awareness.
Yeah.
And there's an article in there about you, how to feel great and be beautiful at any age. Mm-hmm. And I know the crew couldn't even, they didn't believe how old you were.
No, I'm ancient, you know.
You're ancient.
Hollywood style. I just turned 56 last Sunday.
Happy birthday again. Tell us a little bit about that, what you mean by the natural health group.
Actually, I am, considering I come from the, you know, the so-called Man's Magazine world of Playboy magazine.
Right.
I actually came to America in 1975 as a Playmate of the Month, and then I became Playmate of the Year in 1976. And through all those years, 32 years now, I've done, you know, movies in Germany, I've appeared on American television shows, television commercials there and here. And I had my daughter at 40, and you know, I got to be 50 years old, and I thought, oh, and I wrote a health book when I was pregnant with my daughter called Feel Great, Be Beautiful Over 40. And then when I turned 50, I thought to myself, you know, there must be something more to me than all this physical stuff and, you know, sex appeal and looking good, you know. And I had done the book in my 40s, and I thought, I really want to go into the health and fitness and the aging field in America. And it's about 6 months ago since I started really heavy with that, and I'm going into my fourth expo in Pasadena in 2 weeks. It's called the Body, Mind, and Spirit Expo. And I'm the keynote speaker opening night.
Opening night.
2 hour seminar, 2 hour workshop, and you know, my life now is about really helping people get rid of the fear of aging. Because I had to work on that myself, because when I was 30, and I remember I was at a Playboy mansion, there was this big party for Playboy turning 25. And I was 27, and I remember I was looking around, all the girls, 18, you know, when you're 27, you're looking at 18-year-olds, you feel very old.
So really?
It's amazing, you know. 27, oh my God, I'm getting going to be 30. Oh, panic, panic, panic. What am I going to do? And then I was sent by my voice coach, Laura Hart, here in the Valley, who couldn't teach him because I was always depressed by turning 30 almost. And I had, you know, negative attitude, and I had anxiety almost attacks, and I had depression, and I was really a mess. And she said, you go and see this doctor friend of mine, Gene Stanley, and he will help you get over the fear of aging and all these kind of anxiety attacks that you're getting and all that, and look at life in a more positive way and getting older in a more positive way. And I started on that path, and it's so funny. When I turned 40, that was like nothing. 50 was like nothing, but it, at the same time, it was a very positive wake-up call, because I think you do get to see, or you know, you're looking at your mortality all of a sudden when you're 50. Yes. And you go, well, I'm 50, you know, what do I want to do with my other 50? And then that's how I got into this health thing and thinking to myself, well, I want to make a positive, better positive place around me. I want to leave this planet one day, maybe in another 100 years, maybe I'll be 150, right? And, you know, with all this healthy living I do. And I thought, how can I help people with what I have learned up to this age? And that's how I got into this. And now I'm doing my second book, Feel Great, Be Beautiful at Any Age, and doing all the health expos. I'm going to in Arizona, Sedona, in October 14th. I'll be speaking at the Raw Spirit Festival in Sedona, Arizona. And I'm a keynote speaker there, too.
Now, Raw Spirit, what is that about?
Raw Spirit Fest. It's actually a big celebration. It's the biggest on the planet. It's the third year they have it in Arizona, in Sedona. And it's the biggest, most, you know, wonderful event of people coming in to celebrate, you know, natural way of life.
You mean eating natural food and
yeah, natural food, you know, great spiritual type of life, you know, about, you know, instead of taking from life, you know, you give back, you contribute. It's about all these, from what I understand, all these wonderful people who are getting together for 3 days in Arizona and Sedona, in that beautiful place, very spiritual place. I've heard, I've never been there. I'm going to go up by plane one day and stay 2 days, get to know all these people and then fly back to LA, you know. Yeah. But I feel very honored that people are looking at me as a candidate to go and speak about health, fitness and anti-aging. And especially, you know, since I have a very sexy background with Playboy.
You know, that helps.
Yeah, I think I've done 8 covers of Playboy. I wish I had them here. I could show you what I used to look like many years ago. And but you can Google my name, Lillian Müller, and you can probably find my website out there and everything and go and check it out. But, you know, it's great that you can have like a second career after 50. And I'm just saying to all the women out there, you know, 40 and beyond, you know, don't worry about you get some lines, because I've never been to the doctor and taken away my lines. So I always ask the director, can you make sure you fill me in a little bit here? Because, you know, I have a little bit of aging right in here. And I want to look as good as I can, of course, on camera. But at the same time, I don't want to pay the price going into the plastic surgeon's office and have myself cut up and stretched. So I don't want to do that. So,
I mean, your face is incredible.
For my age, it's good.
For any age,
I guess. But you know what it is? It's really that God has given me this incredible energy. That's something I am born with. I always had that, you know, and I've always been a big optimist and enthusiastic person. And I always look at the glass half full, you know, like right now they gave me a glass of cold water out there. And you know, it's an art. Every morning you wake up and you look at this life that you have, and you go, you know, there's always more positive than negative in your life. And the more you positive on the think of the positive, the more positive you get. You know, I haven't read this book yet, The Secret, that's out there. No, my father and my daughter had it at his house. Somebody gave it to him as a present. It's like a big present going around to everybody in Hollywood right now, you know. And I'm going to read it. But it all starts with where you're coming from. The Secret.
Oh, okay.
So besides reading my book, you know, Feel Great and Beautiful Over 40, you can still get that on my site, and you can Google it and get it on Amazon.com, I think. But, you know, I think that's a book that, you know, it reminds people that, you know, we are so much in charge of our life. You know, every day, you know, like the movie Dead Poets Society with Robin Williams.
Right.
I think we talked about that a little bit, you and I. You know, seize the day and make your life extraordinary. The day, the hour, the moment, the minute, the second. I mean, you break it all the way down. And when you get up in the morning, you know, you get up like you're thinking, God, oh, I had this bad dream. Oh, I can't pay my rent, you know. My boyfriend or husband dumped me for some younger... No, it's not happening to me. Not yet. Knock on wood. But you never know, right? Instead of focusing on all that, oh, my daughter is doing bad in school, her grades are going down, too much boys, you know, like I have with my teenager daughter right now, you know. If I focus on that, you know, it's easy to get depressed. Then I get up and I think, well, I'm going to focus on what a wonderful person my daughter is, you know. Okay, so a little hormonal right now, you know, 16, 17, everything. But in general, she's so great, you know. And I still have a boyfriend who hasn't dumped me by a younger woman, so not going to worry there, you know, because she'd be happy for that, right? And, you know, I'm in this great time of life, and I can go out and develop this second career as a public speaker for health, fitness, and anti-aging. And I just love my life. And then people say, yeah, but you're 56. And I'm going, yeah, 56, that's nothing. Think of it, you know, the lifespan today, we have a chance to live way over 100. 56 is nothing, really nothing. So all those 40-year-old women that I meet out there, you know, they're like, oh my God, you're 56, and you tell people about it?
Yeah. Especially in Hollywood.
And in Hollywood, you won't tell people about you're 56? I said, yeah, but you know, for me, it's like, you know, take it or leave it. Yeah. I mean, somebody's always going to love me for me, you know. I think I have a good personality, and I have a lot of wisdom and knowledge, and I want people to love me for that. I don't want people to love me because I'm a plastic person, you know, who's perfect and don't have any character, you know what I mean? What kind of life is that, yeah. You know? I'd rather avoid those people, how's that?
Yeah. So, you know. Now, all your public speaking and everything, has the studio helped you in any way since you've been going there? Has it changed anything in your looking at things?
Well, the actor studio, you know, in the actor studio, of course, they have one on the East Coast and one here in right. Hollywood. It's great to be there for me because it's so much, you know, it's so much based on talent. It's based on talent.
Right.
You can't get in there by paying money, and you cannot get in there by sex appeal. So it's like, wow, that's like, wait, one place in Hollywood, you know, it's not based on sex appeal and money.
Right.
So I think it's
the only place.
Probably, yeah, well, yeah, I haven't been that long, but okay, the only place. And I think it's so great. In my whole life, now I'm in the actor studio, not based on money and sex appeal. Yeah. And I'm the public speaking person, you know, go out and tell people about how you can feel great and be beautiful and be healthy at any age, you know. My whole life is now about who I am as a human being. You know, it's come full circle in a way, you know, where when I was in my 20s and in Europe working on all these sexy movies and this big Playmate of the Year sex symbol, and there was so much pressure to look perfect, you know. I couldn't leave the house without makeup. And Hefner was my first boyfriend in America, and I lived with him for a whole year. And every day I get out of bed, I got to put my makeup on, you know. It's now for camera, I have a little makeup, but, you know, my God, every day, you know. All based on your body and how sexy you look and your faces, how beautiful you look. It gets to be so old. And I was always thinking, one day when I grow up, when I become an older person, I'm not going to do plastic surgery, and I'm going to go out and I'm going to have a real life, a real job. Yeah. And I'm going to attract all the right men for all the right reasons, you know what I mean? All those yeah. men that I want to attract in my 20s, you know? The good men, you know, they don't want a handbag. They don't want some sexy young woman just to show off, oh, I can get a young woman, you know, look at me, I'm 60, 70 years old, but I can still do it well, you know, here I had this young woman. And they don't realize that women are only with them because they got a good address in Bel Air or something.
That's right.
Great car, you know what I mean, the fanciest clothes and big job with a lot of money. You know, and most men are so insecure, they need to be proven that, you know, they're still, I don't know, whatever, sexuality yeah. or something.
I've always been attracted to older women. You know, when I in my 20s, I always yeah. loved women in their 50s and
yeah, I've always been
40s.
Attracted.
You know, I mean, there's something about
a
woman.
Yeah, well, that person, you know, I think every decade, first of all, has this, like, you're perfect. Every decade, you have a full package. You know, it just little changes, you know. Yeah. When you're youth, you know, when you're 20s and 30s, you don't have any lines, you're like flawless, you know. But what kind of wisdom you got to offer? What yeah. kind of life knowledge and what kind of life experience? So for me, I would rather be in my 50s now with some lines and some character. People take me a little more serious, you know. Yeah. But I still attract the young guys, they still won't take me out. It's unbelievable.
God.
You know, I go, hey, do you know, call me Auntie Lillian, I say to them. I said, you know, I'm like, I'm 56, and now I'm 56. I used to say 55 for a whole year, right? And I go, 55, but you look 40. Yeah. 40 is kind of hip still, you know. I'm going to try and make 55 hip out there. You know, you got to do something positive, you know.
And you're going to be doing a reality show, right?
Yeah, I just finished wrapping that reality TV show, and I'm actually one of the stars in the show. It's two stars.
What is it? Can you talk about it? Or?
Well, it's a little bit about, you know, me pursuing a second career in my 50s. How I'm coming from the world of Playboy into public speaking career and keynote speaking at all the health expos and this big raw food festival in Arizona, and how I basically want to travel the world, and I'm getting myself a really good agent to represent me worldwide so I can go worldwide and also in the corporate world, not right. just in the health expo market.
Mm.
And, you know, so they're going to pursue me, how they're going to photograph me and go with me, and how I can achieve that goal. you know, coming from a Playmate of the Year with eight covers, you know, big record with Playboy, besides Pamela Anderson, I think we're the most photographed in the magazine's history. So going from that, which is the ultimate in looking good and having sex appeal, I guess, to becoming a public speaker and showing you got brains and you got intelligence, you got something much more beyond, you know, looking good and being sexy. And they want to kind of, you know, want to capture that on camera, how I do in my new career.
Well, how does it feel with the camera following you around, trying to be real? How is that real?
No problem with that. No. I actually read some, I don't know, I was going to the movies the other night and I saw this, you know, where they have like lines from famous people, you know, when you before the movie start, quotes, you know. And I don't know, Carmen Electra, I think it was, that I saw. She said, oh, I don't feel alive unless the camera is on me. Something like that, you know, and I thought, oh, my
God. Sounds like something she would say.
What has the world come to, you know, in a way? But I guess I'm a little bit still of an exhibitionist, and I like to show other women that it can be done in the 50s. You know, just because you were a sex symbol before 50 and all that, and if you are a serious person and you want to really do something that takes some real stuff to accomplish, I think that 50 is nothing, and I want to really show that to other women, you know, 50s could be the beginning of a whole new life.
Yeah.
And I like that's good to be photographed and shown on television. I think I have a mission with it, you know.
Well, how many cameras do follow you?
Well, it's like two.
And what about...
That's cute producer.
How do you get private
time? Very sexy, good producer, great director, people are all great and they're fun. And I flirt and I have fun with everybody, you know, flirting is not, you know. What do they say? You can read a menu, but don't have to eat everything, you know what I mean? So it's like that, you know, I have all these great people working with me. Yeah. And they're happily married and have children. And I have my daughter and I'm in a serious relationship. And, you know, we have so much fun.
Now, I know people that are... like the background of a lot of these reality shows, and not really reality shows, a lot of them are scripted and...
No script. No lines, not being fed any lines by any director in my ear. I don't have that thing, you know, that I did years ago. I had something, I was doing a so-called reality show in Europe, and they're like, oh, say this, oh, yes, stir it up.
That's what I mean.
You know, man, this is no lines, there's no script, there's nothing. It's just get into the situation and go for it.
Really?
Yeah. It's all none.
So it's
no preparation.
It's really, really.
It's really sink or swim. It's like, you know, wow, am I going to fall on my, you know, face here? Or am I going to, you know, really get something done in this scene, you know?
But that's good. That's where I like to do the show.
It's scary, though.
Yeah,
it's like coming here today. You know, we have no preparation. I have no idea what we're going to talk about. I come here.
I have no idea.
1 hour in the bakery out there with 113 degrees right now, and my car is like starting to overheat. The air conditioner is going, you know, still sweating, wondering about, oh, my God, you know, what's going to happen? So.
And that's it, you know. That's what's great about that is because we don't know what's going to happen in life.
No, but that's the great thing about the Actor's Studio, going back to the Actor's Studio that I'm learning there, you know. This thing about, you know, Martin Landau and, you know, they're talking about, you know, when you start a scene, you be there right on from the beginning, 100% from the beginning. You don't build up in the scene. Right. You really go in there and you're 100% in the moment prepared. Right. Let it all hang out and break loose. It's also, you know, almost like an explosive kind of thing that happens. I love that.
Yes.
See, I love that in life. Yeah. I love the moment to moment. That's why it's hard for me always, you know, to settle down to get married to one man because, you know, I think life is about meeting people and getting to know people and that initial thing in relationships with a man, woman, I think that's one of the most fantastic things that can happen. You know, discovery process with a man or a woman, right? And you know, who are you with? And that whole thing in discovering, it's like, you know, when I had my daughter, it's like she was a little, like in the beginning, it's like a little rosebud that's closed, you know? And every year the rose opens up and it's become like a full-fledged rose and now she's 17, you know? Almost totally complete and it's the same thing as, you know, relationships, all these new people you meet when you travel. And unfortunately the way it is with marriage, you know, when you're in a marriage, seems to me like so many people, you know, they are insecure and they want to own you and possess you and tell you what to do and you can't see this person and that person. God forbid you want to go for lunch and talk and share with some other male or, you know, for a man, the female, you know. I think we have to, if you're going to get in married and have successful relationships, you know, it's almost like you've got to let it go. You're going to let that person go and unless that person is free to develop himself or herself to his or her fullest potential without you, you know, looking like a spy almost over their shoulder and when are you coming home and who are you seeing? You can't have that. You're going to kill the relationship. Yeah. And I've been very guilty of doing that myself in my relationships in the past. And it's something I'm learning. To have a successful relationship at home, you got to trust God.
You have to let it go and let people be who
because,
they are.
You know, and that's hard. And especially for me because I guess, what did my daughter say yesterday? She says, you are an eccentric, whatever, eccentric.
That's a word.
Intense personality. I want to be normal.
Intense,
you know,
yes.
With my daughter and all that, and I'm out in life. But, you know, you are what you are. And even at home, you are what you are. You can't put a lid on it. You got to be open. And I like people who are eccentric and a little bit unusual. I don't like the conventional type of man and conventional type of situations. And I attract, I guess, wild and crazy people in a way, you know, but also sane, because they're all spiritual and they're all like people who want to be the best they can be and have big goals and dreams. And, you know, but they said, it was one of my books, I have a spiritual book, you know, they say that if a person is really creative and very smart, you know, well, there's always some other thing there that, you know, you've got to take the good with the bad, you know what I mean? And if you want to be this person who is like that highly creative and so smart and intellectual, maybe a genius type of person, you know, there's always something you're not going to like. The dark side, you know, and I'm sure I have a dark side too, you know. All I know that I'm a vegetarian, a vegan, and once in a while, you know, I got to have mashed potatoes. So, you know, it's my dark side, you know.
Mashed potatoes is well, a dark side?
Yeah, well, but I found the best place in
LA. As a vegan, you can't have mashed
potatoes?
You're
a vegan,
potatoes?
No dairy, right?
Well, potatoes are not.
Yeah, but most of the time, like in America, you know, Thanksgiving, you know, they put milk and the butter and the salt and all that stuff. Mashed potatoes. And then the gravy goes on and God knows what's in the gravy, right? Oh, my God. Who knows what all those cooks in all those kitchens around America and their restaurants put in that gravy? And then you go to turkey. Well, you know, I don't eat turkey. But you know what I found as a vegan, because I'm not even a vegetarian now. I have progressed to veganism.
Yeah,
and organic veganism, I'd say 95% of the time. So I'm pretty fanatic in what I put into my system. But, you know, the thing is that, you know, if you have a big goal to look great all your life and to have so-called sex appeal, which, you know, the world, you know, if you're great looking, they think you've got sex appeal, especially if you've got a little energy to to back it up, right? So my goal, I love to be a sexy woman. I love to be an attractive woman. You know, I can't say I don't. I got to be real. And I love to get older and keep my thing. And I know that it's a prize to keep your thing.
Right.
You got to eat right. You got to think positive and enthusiastic. You got to have wild, big goals and dreams and go for it and surround yourself with positive, big winners in life, you know, people that you want to be around, because people rub on you.
Right.
And you got to exercise and you got to like the food. It's very important, I think, food. I don't know, 60-70% important when you want to, you know, keep your curves and you don't want cellulite and you want to have a streamlined body like I think I have. I mean, my body is pretty much, you know, I didn't bring my pictures. Google my name, Lilian, while you go to my site.
Yeah.
You can see, right? But the thing is that, you know, if you're going to have that goal and you're going to have skin that is not wrinkled up and not saggy, you know, maybe 60 and 70 and beyond, there's the price. You've got to work on your mind. You've got to be a positive, optimistic person, like I said, a constructive individual. Focus on the day and what you can do, because you know something, next Monday you might not be here. So that thing about purpose is very important, and that thing about doing your best every day and not procrastinating, because when I was young, I could have been so much further in my career today if I did not procrastinate. It was always Monday, you know. Next month, next year, or when I grow up, when I become more mature, when I'm getting more educated, you know, when I get some lines in my face and I can have some character to back up, you know, and people take it more seriously, I'll be this big star or whatever I had in my mind, you know. Well, before you know it, you are 50.
That's it. We put things off and then.
Yes. And insecurities take over, you know, and you go, you know, who am I, you know, and especially with my Playboy background as a sex symbol, you know, that is a tough one.
Yeah.
And you go into the business, you want to be a serious actor, so you want to be a serious person or somebody that you know, people have respect for and you are legitimate individual, you know, or people take you, you know, you with respect. I mean, that is, you know, that is hard when you are a sex symbol somehow and you take your clothes off.
Well, that's one of the reasons why now that you're with Actors Studio,
yes,
people have to take you and give you respect because they're
going to make them take me serious.
Well, I mean,
like, you
know, you are serious.
It's the beginning, you know,
and they know that now when they, you know, when you tell people you're with Actors Studio, I mean, they have to step back and whoa.
But you know, this thing about serious, you know, people go, well, serious, what does that mean? Well,
what does it mean?
For me, it's like the respect is important, because I felt that when I was Playmate of the Year and 30 years posing for the magazine, and, you know, I've probably done 40 pictorials, you know, it's like I don't control how much I work with that magazine, an international Playboy and all over. In my country, all the men's magazines, the classy ones, of course, I never went any worse than Playboy with nudity, because I think you'd take your clothes off, it has to be done with class. And you can't lose your dignity in the process, no matter what kind of money they offer you. I never did any softcore movies or pornography, never any of that. It was Playboy, and basically that was it. I had some nude scenes in some movies in Germany, but it was very tastefully done. It was straight films, with no softcore, no French stuff, you know.
Right.
And, but I had this thing, you know, when I was young. I wanted to be like Liv Ullmann, you know. I didn't want to be like Brigitte Bardot, you know, it's a big sex symbol.
Your voice and everything, and your look reminds me of her.
Yeah, well, people say, oh, Brigitte Bardot, second Marilyn Monroe, second. Well, first of all, that really bothered me. I didn't want to be second anybody. I'm a Leo, for God's sake. Do you think I want to be a second somebody? I want to be who I am to the fullest and be me. Right, but when you're young, you are so insecure, and no matter how beautiful you are and how people look up to you and people tell you all this stuff, you know, compliments, empty compliments, right? And you get confident, but you get confident, in my opinion, for the wrong reasons. Mm. Because it's all about what you look like and how sexy you can look in a picture. Yeah. What kind of life is that? And what kind of goal is that? And now girls come up to me, oh, can you get him into Playboy? I want to be a centerfold. Like, that's the ultimate thing, you know. They want to be centerfolds. And I'm thinking to myself, that is not something to aspire to. And especially if you want to have a so-called serious career. And now we're getting back to the serious. It's when people take you seriously, offer you roles and jobs where it takes brains and it takes intelligence. It takes, you know, some kind of energy and awareness and a consciousness to accomplish.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think young girls and women who want to sell their soul to the devil, do your pictures on the internet, you know, post a penthouse, or I shouldn't say a name of me, that's wrong. But, you know, any kind of so-called dirty, sexy magazines, post that. But you know something, you're selling your soul to the devil. There is no future after that, unfortunately.
Unfortunately.
Yeah. If I'd done something worse than Playboy, or something less classy than Playboy, I would not be in the actor studio, I bet. And I would not be able to do the public speaking career that I'm in the process of building up right now.
No, because, I totally agree.
And people who have intelligence, if you feel, girls, that you have something on the ball, don't take the easy route. Don't go the easy way. Because in the long run, it is not, it's going to come back and haunt you. You get married one day, you want to have a serious career. Because, you know, 20s is good. You don't want to be a checkout girl at the supermarket. And I understand how it's easy. You know, marry a rich man for money, you know.
That's true. I got to tell you, there's three things in life. There's family, making love, the smell of Italian gravy on a Sunday morning.
Vegan gravy.
No, well, you can have that. Or go to Frankie's on Melrose. But, and we, you know, her name is spelled with a U, Lillian Miller. Now, just Google her name and you're going to see some incredible things.
Two dots over the U.
Well, they don't have to do that to Google your name.
Yeah, but
I don't even know how to do that.
I like to attract all the right men for all the right reasons. So maybe they shouldn't Google my name. They'll see my past, you know what I mean? But, hey, you know, in the future, it's all the best to come, I think.
And we're wrapping it up, and I really want to thank you for coming on again.
Thank you.
What a gift
can
you really are.
Can I come back soon?
You can come back anytime.
I want to come back soon. So much anytime. Fun here. Thank you.
Anytime.
Thank you.
And I know this thing is going to be great. I'm so happy you're with the studio.
Yeah, thank you.
I love watching you when you come in.
You
know,
you come in
like this little shy little girl.
I am shy. You know, I'm still overcoming my shyness. You know, you've got to work on that one. That's not
a done
deal. And
you have a big fan. You know, Martin really thinks the world of you.
Yeah, now I've got to go and do some real good explosive scenes at the Actors Studio.
Well, that's what we're waiting for.
Yeah, I'm going to be doing that this fall.
Okay.
So, yeah.
And we're wrapping it up, and thank you. And I want to thank you.
And now the purple dusk of twilight time steals across the meadows of my heart. High up in the sky, the little stars climb, always reminding me that we're apart. You wander down the lane and far away, leaving me a song that will not die. Love is now the stardust of yesterday, the music of the years gone by.